Friends, welcome to the Book Nerds podcast. It's an awesome day today because we have, it's always great to have professionals from the publishing industry with us. And it is not often that we manage to get them. So thank you guys for being here. I would like to welcome both Priya Kapoor and Kapil Kapoor from Roly Books. They are directors at Roly Books, and we would like to talk to them about the books that are coming out. Of course, the legacy of Roly Books. I mean, a 40-year-old legacy, and which is a pretty hard thing to do in publishing. So we would like to discuss all of that. And first of all, welcome to the Book Nerds podcast.
Yeah, thank you. It's great to be here. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you great. For having us.
So first of all, thank you for this. This is my favorite okay. book of all time. Thanks a lot okay. for this one. And moving on, tell me something. It's lockdown time. I mean, it must be pretty hard to manage a publishing house right now because there's so many parameters. I mean, you have to take care of your employees, the team, of course, be in touch with your authors, editors, and also engage at the readers at the same time. So how does that work out?
I think this lockdown is, you know, difficult for anybody, for everybody and for all businesses, however, whichever industry you're in. Yeah. Of course, every industry has its own peculiar, you know, limitations and issues as well. And yes, ours is a very people-oriented business. As you rightly said, it's not just, you know, an internal team, but we're in touch with authors, photographers, designers, freelancers, yeah. who all depend on the publishing house. And unfortunately, while we cannot be producing new books or reprinting books at the moment because of the physical yeah. constraints of printing presses being shut, bookshops, the whole sort of machinery is shut down. You know, in many ways, publishing house's work is always to be coming up with new ideas, keeping people engaged, keeping our authors busy, keeping our team busy. And this is pretty much on, you know, day one of lockdown, we decided to focus our energy on doing that and to continue to function in keeping the basic principles of a publishing house. Of course, it's hugely frustrating because we had books lined up. We have books which are lying at the printing press at the moment. And it's disappointing to the authors as well. But we have to be mindful that, you know, everybody is in this together and we're all doing the best that we can. And yeah. it's important to keep everyone's spirits up and to keep everybody engaged. And I think we are doing a good job as far as that is concerned.
Great. Kapil?
Yeah, I'd add to that, you know, I think in the first few days of the lockdown, I think it was more of practical considerations about running a company. I think that's the first few things we were thinking about, you yeah. know, in terms of, and things were changing so quickly, you know, there was, every day there was a new set of restrictions that were coming about. So yeah. first, we thought we would be able to get books to our readers through the online channels,
right.
Because the shops were closed, but at least that was there. But then that quickly, you know, closed down as well. So, like Priya said, I think we are quite a nimble kind of a team, and we work pretty fast on our decisions. Yeah. So from day one, what we decided was that, you know, go back to the roots of what a publishing company, and especially what a publishing company like Roly Books is all about, which generally is we are storytellers. We are content creators. For us, we really, you know, we work with our authors and we try and get the best of their stories across to our readers. Yeah. Of course, for 40 years, we've done it through the print mechanism. Yeah. And at the moment, because of the lockdown, when we realized that the print mechanism is no longer an yeah. option for us, then we just very quickly, you know, like everybody else, moved on to the digital platform yeah. and said we should continue at least that theme of bringing stories from our authors, whether they've been, we've worked with them in the past or some new, you know, partnerships, and just get content to our readers at this time. And because, and then we changed according to the format. You know, there are certain things you can do in print that you can't do in digital. So there's been a great learning over the last 2 weeks about what works and what doesn't work. But yeah, it's been, for us, it's been quite a roller coaster of 2 weeks, and we're actually thoroughly enjoying it because, you know, we're learning a lot at this time.
You talked about being a, you know, nimble sort of team. We'll come back to that. But before that, let's talk about Mr. Pramod Kapoor, the founder back in 1978. I mean, it must have been a hard task setting up a publishing house anyways. I believe, did he come from Kolkata to Delhi? Am I right? No,
he was born in Calcutta because his mother came from Calcutta, but he grew up in Banaras, in Varanasi. He went to school and college there. Okay. And right after his undergrad degree, he got actually into a program at Macmillan in Delhi, where they were, it was a trainee program. Okay. And then from there is where his publishing career began. But his mother came from a publishing family, so he'd been exposed to the business and the workings of it. So yes, to answer your question, I think, I mean, when you look back now, it definitely was quite a bold, maverick decision, you know. And that too, to get into something as niche as sort of illustrated books, where the market was limited and, the you know, in terms of technology or printing was not readily available. So he had to print in Singapore or in the Far East. So it was all very ambitious for somebody who was only 26. Yeah.
Printing in Singapore.
He was 26 years old. That's where we began. And I think... And, you know, there he kind of, or the founding of Roly Books sort of principles, which comes back to quality, to always kind of be ambitious, dream larger, and you will get to it, you know. Some of those principles have really trickled down into the DNA of the company. And he's still very much involved in the business. I think books and, you know, publishing is something that you can't really retire from.
Right.
So he, you know, he still ideates. He's got a very good visual eye. And in terms of production and giving, you know, final touches to, he works very closely with the design and production team. So, that's...
It's the kind of books you produce, Kapil, it's almost like the movie making process, perhaps, because it needs a lot of direction. There's storytelling, of course, all of those elements. Tell me something, what would Mr. Kapoor say at a meeting of Roly Books? I mean, what are the top three things your team would listen from him?
You know, actually, it's quite interesting you said that. I mean, he's also instilled a culture of brainstorming and meetings where everybody really has a contributory voice because ideas can come from anywhere.
Right.
And I think most publishing houses have that where, you know, when you're brainstorming, you pick up on one person's idea and you build on it. So I think from his point of view really is that we should be innovative and we should think about our own ideas and curate the kinds of books that we want to do, commission them, and then go out and find the best people to be able to kind of realize that idea.
Okay.
And that's really where everything starts at Roly. So everybody thinks about, it can be marketing, it could be production, it could be editorial, about a theme, about a topic which we feel we should do. And then it starts really, that's the seed of it. And then it just keeps building from there. And sometimes it becomes very ambitious. You know, a simple idea becomes that we must do a bigger book, we must do a two-volume book, we must do it in a lavish way.
Yeah.
So it does happen, you know, where everyone's dreaming a lot and thinking kind of, you know, two steps ahead. And that always helps us because whatever book that eventually comes out is bigger and better than what we originally imagined it to be.
Right.
Whether it's an illustrated book or it's a non-illustrated book, I think our ambition is always quite big, you know, for that. So yeah, his contribution in a meeting, you know, to answer your specific question, is always encouraging everybody to participate and to think bigger and to be also innovative in whatever we do. So not just follow the trends, but to set the trend.
Okay. I was reading your catalog on your website, and it's like you've covered a lot of history. I mean, I don't know. I didn't love my history books that much, but if they looked like that, I mean, I would have loved them so much better. And you have mentioned that you had to fight a lot of odds also over the years. For example, you have mentioned that sometimes the corporates would not, you know, like some ideas or be averse to it. So what happens then? I mean, how do you take this forward, you know, looking, taking into consideration, this question is to Priya.
I think you, by this, do you mean like sort of publishing difficult books or sensitive books?
Yes,
is that what you mean?
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
Okay. No, I mean, you know, we've obviously come across quite a few in the 42 years, and we've commissioned a few. Some have come to us as well. where, you know, before publication, either we've received a notice or after publication, etc. But I think, you know, that's something that as a publishing house and more, I mean, other publishing houses as well, you have to stick by. As long as you have faith in what the author has written is to be authentic, it's to be validated, substantiated, you've chosen to work with that author and that manuscript, and you've taken it to, you know, you've contracted them and so on, you have to stand by the book and the author. And there are enough precedents of, you know, the law favoring you. So, you know, you have to be courageous, you have to do the right thing. And also, in many ways, I just feel like, you know, of course, it's intimidating when, you know, big lawsuits with large numbers and so on are slapped against you. But there's a lot of really good legal advice available for publishers and for authors. And I just feel like, you know, as long as you know that the book is has been substantiated, it is it's true to the best of the author's abilities and so on, it's your responsibility to back it and put it out there. And in our experience, we found that, okay, these notices could be like intimidation tactics, but we worked, you know, nothing has happened, as in we've gone ahead and the book has done well and it's got a life beyond, you know, the immediate,
Okay, so it's the Book Nerds podcast. Let's talk about some books. What are the books, Kapil, you are excited about? Of course, it's going to come out later on. But what are the books that are in the making or have come out this year or previous year?
Yeah.
Would you like to share some books?
Sure. I think I'll speak about one book which is top of mind right now. And I think we've been working on it for, well, you can say a good 2 or 3 years now. Okay. And hopefully, you know, with the, you know, keeping the current situation, we don't know how long it'll last, but if everything goes well, it should be published later this year. And this is an illustrated biography of His Holiness the Dalai Lama. It is possibly, if I can say so myself, one of the most intimate biographies that's ever been written on him. And the reason we say that is, one is obviously because of the visual nature of it. We've got access to some incredibly rare personal photographs, which kind of mark his journey from the time that he was in Tibet, crossed over, and his time in India. So visually, it's an absolutely, you know, it's a rare and absolute treasure. In addition to that, the text for the book is also being, I mean, the author is somebody who is extremely special. He was the personal secretary to His Holiness for 40 years and worked with him and traveled with him all over the world, met all the state leaders and so on. He retired earlier, I mean, about 10 years ago. So he's the author of the book, Tenzin Geshi Taitong is his name. Okay. So it's a very, it's sort of the format of the book follows on from a book that we had published a few years ago. It was an illustrated biography of Gandhi, which my father incidentally wrote. Yes. So the format of the book, the size and the visual nature of it is similar. So you can say in a way it's the sort of the second in the series.
Okay. This will also go out in multiple languages like Gandhi?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. In fact, more languages than Gandhi has. Because we've already contracted about 8 or 9 foreign languages, including countries like Lithuania, Estonia, Czech Republic, Russian, Dutch, French, German. Wow. So it's really
Italian.
Italian. All of Europe, global, almost.
Yeah. It's a global publication, and it's going to be something which is. We're really proud of it, and I hope that this lockdown ends quickly so that we can get it in the hands of everyone. Yeah. So this Looking is one forward. Book that I'm really excited about. Yeah. Priya, of course, will have her favorite.
Kapil's absolutely right to start with the Dalai Lama. The book has consumed our lives in the most beautiful way for the last 2 years. But apart from that, there are 3 books which were to come out imminently, you know, within the next sort of 3 to 5, which I'm really excited about. One is the autobiography, the memoirs of Bacha Khan, who he'd basically written it in Pashto, but it had been translated as an abridged version in English many years ago. Okay. But as a complete volume, it's never been translated and published in English before. Okay. So we have been working with a member of his family who has done a translation in English, right, and a lady in Pakistan who's facilitated the whole thing. Right. And it's a big book. It's an ambitious book because it was sort of like his own thoughts. He'd never sort of written it as a whole book. So editing it and working with them to get it right. So that's going to be a very it's an important book to publish. Yeah. Yeah. So that is one. Another one is it's a book called India, A Story in 100 Objects. It's by Vidya Dehejia, who's one of the foremost authorities on art history and Indian art history. She teaches at Columbia in New York. Okay. And we've been working with her for the last 2 years. And it's a very, very interesting take on Indian history and Indian art, because she's identified pieces and objects which would regularly and normally not really meet this list, this kind of a list. So while yes, some of the greats are definitely there, she's got her own interpretation of why these other pieces need to be in there. So we're very excited about that. And the third is actually a book that we'd commissioned almost 9 months ago, but it's just suddenly that it's one of those like lovely publishing coincidences that is very topical. And it's a book called The House of Sindhya. By Rashid Kidwai, who's a very senior journalist and a best-selling author. And he's based out of Bhopal and has been writing and following the Sindhya family for a long time. And we commissioned him to do this book purely on the basis of that it's a fascinating family, There was a time that they were, on two different political sides. Yes. They belonged to a very, powerful ruling family, and then they've gone on to become political figures. There's a lot of glamour, intrigue, politics, history. Human stories. So that's all the manuscript in. We're getting it as we speak, and I hope once this lockdown is over, we can get it out to our readers.
Sure. And Kapil, you talked about the entrepreneurial spirit of Rowley Books. Why do you say that? Because I know your team is quite lean, and it's quite productive in that way, and churning out great content. Because it's a 42-year-old company. So how does that entrepreneurial spirit, stay with you?
I think, two or three things. I mean, one is like, that is the, we spoke about, the founder and what was happening in the early 80s. So this is a culture that's just kind of stayed throughout, right? Okay. And also, if you see the history, our 40-year history, we made a small film on it on our anniversary. And that encapsulated really well, because every sort of five to 7 years, there was almost like a startup within a startup, the publishing company was formed. And then, there was another a journalistic venture where a newspaper was started. And then, sort of the next 5 years we started a new imprint. So you will see that every five, then we got into, foreign language publishing. Then we got into book distribution, where we started working with other publishers from overseas and representing them here. So I think there is that culture that has moved along of always being starting something new. So we've always had these little startups that have been going on. So that is, I would say, the biggest biggest attribute towards this. Okay. And the second reason I would put down to is that we've always been sort of a mid-sized company. Yeah. So we've never been too large. The teams have always been there. And we've always had to compete with bigger forces, bigger forces. So in one way of, being relevant is staying ahead of the curve. Where you can't compete, maybe sometimes with financial muscle or money power, you can compete in terms of being innovative, being quick, and being creative. So I think this is where it's almost also a little bit about survival, which comes in, that if you need to stay relevant, if you need to stay top of mind, you need to be doing something new, you need to be, pushing the envelope. So again, it's a very topical question you've asked, because this time, this 2 weeks that have gone by, we've really, we've thought about doing digital publishing, digital content for a long time. Yeah. But in this lockdown time, a smaller group has formed, and it started off by putting content out to keep our readers engaged. Yes. But in this process, we've launched a digital platform. I mean, we've started another platform called Roly Pulse. Okay. And Roly Pulse will be our digital channel, you can say. Okay. And it is going to continue from now. So now, after lockdown is also over, you will see Roly Books, you will see our publishing and our printing coming out, but you will also see a lot of digital content coming out under Roly Pulse. So this is another example of us just moving quickly and launching something.
So this is on YouTube, social media, or it's a dedicated...
Everywhere.
Great. I wanted to ask about one of my favorite things about Roly Books. They launched, you guys launched a bookstore, and which is quite an anomaly, because not many publishers would venture into that. Everybody knows that it's a tough cookie to crack, right? So tell us something. How did this come about, the CMYK bookstore? For all the viewers, do check it out. It's in 8 locations, is it? Across the country? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So go buy books from CMYK. this is an official plug. Okay.
Thank you.
Priya, tell me, how did this come about? And
So, you know, there are two main reasons why, you know, CMYK came out of Roly Books. One was that, as Kapil said, that one of the new ventures that we had gotten into was distribution of some of the best, finest art book publishers from the world. Yeah. So, you know, we were their sole distributors in India, and therefore we had access to some of the best books published simultaneously in India as well. Secondly, was that, you know, I think it was a little bit of frustration as being a publisher of these large format, beautiful books, that they need visibility. You need to be able to see them. You need to be able to, like, sort of touch, feel, flip through them, and then discover them, because, you know, they're expensive and they need to be found, and they're not found, you know, in general bookstores and so on. Yeah. So visibility, even within a bookshop, was always a problem. For example, the space that one big book takes could be like 5 paperbacks that sell far more quickly. Yeah. So it was also like, you know, in order to sell more, we need to be more visible. So it was totally, I mean, it was a combination of these two, you know, forces that made us want to just start, and purely from a more romantic notion, I mean, which publisher doesn't want to have their own bookshop? You know, where you've got control over which books are out there and how you market them, and, you know, being able to, like, see the reaction of people who are buying your books that you've made. So we decided to go for it, and we were very lucky, because 11 years ago, when we were scouting for places in Delhi, we came across Meher Chand Market, which was a very sleepy, they just had one cafe coffee day on the corner. And it seemed ideal, because it was quite central, and at the same time, it had great parking and other amenities. So we were one of the first. And then after that, you know, Meher Chand Market totally transformed. Okay. And then from there, we were able to open in Bombay, where we've got, like, shop in shops within Crossword, which is a very unique partnership, that we're actually a bookstore within a larger bookstore at the Crossword Kemp's Corner.
Okay.
And then we have our own shop at the Taj, where we over Nalanda, very bookstore, been at the Taj Colaba for many years, and then a shop and shop in Good Earth as well, and then we've got in Chennai and in Pondicherry and so on, Jaipur as well, and we're just relaunching the store in Delhi along with Eureka, which is a very, very loved, they used to be a very loved children's bookstore, and then they're the two forces behind Bookaroo as well. So it's going to be, half of it is going to be CMYK, and half of it is going to be a children's bookstore that does a lot of activities as well.
Okay.
So yeah, that's really where CMYK came from.
Yeah. Kapil, this is a great example of, you know, again, moving quickly and understanding what the business is going towards, having a bookstore with some activities, and also innovating, having the bookshops in places where, you know, generally people don't imagine them to be. How those decisions are taken? I mean, is there data behind it? What is the strategy behind it?
Well, first of all, most of the things we do, don't have data behind it.
Okay.
No, I know.
Most of the things we do really come from gut feel and impulse and, you know, a little
bit of that. So that's great.
I must admit that we are probably the least scientific when it comes to making decisions and more emotional. That's awesome.
That's awesome. Actually, it's awesome.
But to answer your question, you know, frankly, some of these places, it was also a commercial decision because as a bookstore, the places you want to be, the rents are very high.
Right.
So you can't afford to open a bookstore in, you know, the places where you would love to. So a lot of the times we had to forge partnerships. We had to figure out where we would meet, you know, find like-minded people, where the audience, we thought that the audience for our books would also be going to those places.
Yeah.
So for, like Priya said, you know, the Good Earth lifestyle shop in Bombay, they were able to carve out a little space for us for CMYK.
Yeah.
So we had commonalities in terms of our target audience. And so there we could share resources and do that.
But that's, but that's smart and romantic at the same time. You know, you're making great decisions.
It came from a little bit of necessity and a little bit of just trying to combine forces with people so that it could help both sides. And also because our books, I mean, the books that are in CMYK are mainly for the creative community and for the visual arts. So there is a lot of parallels about where those sets of people are going in terms of lifestyle stores, in terms of furniture shops. So we are always on the lookout where we can forge a little partnership.
Okay.
And so the locations, that's why you find them in sort of unusual locations.
But we are not complaining anyways. So Priya, tell me, what about educational institutions? I mean, a lot of reading culture has gone out of them. And since we keep on visiting these schools and colleges, so how does that come in the works at Rolly? I mean, how do you, what is your opinion on that?
You know, so I was saying that, you know, reading, you've made a very good point that reading culture needs to be encouraged at a much younger age, you know, at schools and colleges later on. So Scholastic is already doing some wonderful work where they go into these schools and set up book fairs and bring the books to the kids. Some of our books are available through them. We also have done forged relationships with a lot of design schools, you know, design institutions and so on, where a lot of the books that you find at CMYK would be relevant to them. So not only is that to create awareness about the books, but also like making sure that they're reaching them, they know how to get to them. So those are some other ways. But Kapil, do you have anything to add to this?
Yeah, I think, you know, we publish, our publishing is quite limited when it comes to children and young adults at the moment. So schools really don't feature so much in terms of our, as far as our publishing is concerned. But yet, higher education and especially any sort of art or design or visual mediums, there we do supply a lot of books for this. It's not only the books that we publish, but it's also the books that we distribute. These books do go into their libraries and the HODs do recommend these books for their students. And so, yeah, I think there it's more sort of us trying to, you know, sort of play the distributor's role and ensuring that, you know, these great books that we have access to from around the world, that they find themselves in these libraries so that students from across the country have access to them.
So my final question, it's 21-day lockdown and we are not aware whether it will last till April 14th or not, or it will be extended. A lot of people are reading right now. Some recommendations. Do you get time, first of all, being directors of a publishing house to read? I mean, of course, the business must be requiring you to do so. But what are you reading right now, or any recommendations for our viewers?
I'll start.
I definitely.
I wish that I had more. You know, I thought that I will, under this lockdown, I'll have a lot of time to read and so on. But I think we may have, you know, sort of gotten ourselves so busy that I have like little time to read. But I am. I mean, I'm slowly going through William Dalrymple's book, The Anarchy, which I think a lot of people are reading now.
Yes.
So it's not so much of a unique recommendation, but I'm absolutely loving it. And It's really, yeah. It's wonderful. So I'm taking my time and I'm savoring it because I really don't want it to end.
Great.
So that's the book that I'm...
That's a great recommendation. It's not, it doesn't have to be unique. I mean, it's a great book. Yeah. Priya, any recommendations from you?
I read a lot because it's just something I like to do every day, even if it's just a few pages a day and so on. And I also read multiple books at the same time.
Okay.
So, you know, one could be like fiction, one could be nonfiction, one could be something else. So right now I'm reading a book called Under the Banner of Heaven, which is about Mormonism in America. Okay. It's written by this author who also wrote Into the Wild and Into Thin Air. So it's very well researched and well written. I would recommend that. But as Kapil said, you know, this is a really good time to pick up one of those big books, you know, the ones that you need to really go deeply into.
Right.
I really wish I hadn't reread Suitable Boy last year, because there wouldn't have been a better time than now to reread that. So I would recommend that highly to people. It's a big one, but you know, it's one that it just kind of consumes you, where that's all you want to be doing. You don't want to be like going to work. And so this is, there's no better time than, you know, picking up a book like that. But from the Rolly catalog, because of course there's some incredible gems that you guys, you know, I hope you can get your hands on ebooks and so on.
Right.
There's a lovely spy thriller, which has been set in the Maurya Gupta period. It's called Urnabi, which is soon going to be made into a web series. So that's a very good one. The author is a first time writer called Sumedha Ojha.
Okay.
And, that's available as an ebook. There's another incredible book called The Novel Cure, which is not so much a reading book, but it's a great book to have and to basically refer to right now, because it's a book which basically outlines cures, book cures, where she actually gives you, the authors give you recommendations of books depending on your mood or any ailment you have.
Wow.
So it could be it's very cool. So it's like the Bible of reading lists. There's something for everybody in there, you know, depending on what you feel like.
Right.
And then, of course, we've got like Tanushree Poddar's brilliant trilogy that she wrote on basically these three band of friends who went to the NDA together, and then how they grow up and they become like these special commandos. And so it's like a coming of age story where you follow their story. The first book is called Boots, Belts, Berets. The second one is called On the Double. And the third one is called No Margin for Error. So why I'm recommending this is because it's a beautifully told story, but it's easy to go through. And these are all available as ebooks. So I hope your listeners will find them.
Awesome. Thank you so much, guys, for being on the Book Nerds podcast. Some great recommendations. And we got a chance. I mean, you guys are so busy throughout the year. I mean, this lockdown has given us an opportunity to, you know, interact with you. So something positive has come out of the lockdown.
Definitely.
And looking forward to talking to you guys more, because a lot of people keep asking me, like, you know, how does it work? How do we reach out to publishing houses? I said, just email them, man. Just email them.
Absolutely.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah, that's the best way. Write a good proposal and email us. I'm telling you, we do read them. We do read each and every one of them. Yeah. So
guys, listen, just email them. They are busy, but not for authors and, you know, readers. So thank you so much for being on the Book Nerds podcast. Looking forward to so much more from you guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.